This conference will now be recorded.
Sigma. So x minus mu divided by sigma. Hi, Rakesh. So see, yesterday we discussed until this point, right? So let me just start it from the same. Distances for mixed plus numerical plus categorical data. If you have mixed numerical data plus categorical data, what we should do? So here in this case, what we have to do is for numerical, see here, standardize. This is categorical. This is typing mistake. When I tried to type it, I typed it as that. So standardize categorical variables to 0 and 1. For example, if you're having a column called as gender, male, female, put this male as 1, female as 0. Then use your Euclidean distance formal. This is the simple solution you can do. This is one of the simple solution you can do. Or else if you are really interested to do some complicated things and which is having some small disadvantage, you can go with this particular formula. Gower's general dissimilarity coefficient. Gower's general dissimilarity coefficient. So before going to this Gower's general dissimilarity coefficient, I'm going to tell you one important concept for your categorical data or discrete data. Discrete data. You're having male, male, female, for example. So if two categories are same, for example, this is first record, this is second record. If two categories are same between records, like first record and second record, both are male and male, the distance will be zero.
Zero.
The distance will be zero. And zero. If it is different, male and female, then it will be
one.
If it is different categories, it will be one. If it is of same category, it will be zero. Just note down this point. Based on this, we are going to discuss about your Gower's general dissimilarity coefficient. It's easy only, but I'm explaining in a simpler way. Don't worry about that.
Yogesh, I think we have discussed this yesterday.
Yeah. This one we discussed?
Yeah,
that is the reason. Yesterday I told you, right? At the end, I told you that tomorrow I'm going to continue from this point. That's the reason I'm explaining you.
Okay, yeah.
So consider you're having like this. This is your top 10. And this is your graduation rate. For example, I'm taking only two numerical data. 85, 90. Graduation rate is 80 and 88. And this is my gender column, for example. This is my gender column. One is male and another one is also male. For example, consider this is your first university and second university. Give university names whatever you want. Whatever you want. So what is your Euclidean distance?
2 minus x1
x2 minus square. x1 all square plus
yes.
y2 minus
y1
y1
square.
So this is your x2, y2, x1, y1. And this is your categorical data. So before explaining this part, I'm going for your slides now. Once again. Gower's general dissimilarity coefficient formula is this. Distance of ij is equal to summation of ijk, weight of ijk into distance of ijk. This distance of ijk is nothing but it is calculated on your numerical data. Numerical data. And this weight of ijk is calculated on your categorical data or discrete data. Categorical or discrete data. Now, so as I said you that there are two columns of universities, top 10 and grad rate, 85. So this is male and male gender column. So I need to calculate the distance for your numerical data, distance of ijk. square root of x2 minus x1 whole square is 90 minus 85 whole square. 90 minus 85 whole square is
5 square.
85 minus 88. 85 minus 88.
3 square.
Minus 3 whole square. Minus 3 whole square. So this is my distance of IJ. And I need to calculate the distance for gender. That is your W of IJK. So as it is having same category, what will be the distance between the two same categories?
Zero.
Zero, because both are male and male. It is zero. So how much is 5 square? Square root of 5 square? 25 plus?
25.
Plus 9.
9.
So how much is square root of?
34.
How much is square root of 34?
5.7.
So 5.7 is your distance of IJ, and W of IJ is 0 because you are having same category. 5.7, and here I'm going to replace with 5.7 into weight of IJ. I'm going to write it as 0 divided by weight of IJ is 0. What will be your answer?
0.
Infinity.
Infinity, because anything divided by 0 is also infinity. Infinity. So this is one of the disadvantage of using Gower's general dissimilarity coefficient, but it is summation. So if this university has having different categories, like gender, all the categories like male and female, female, like this, you can have some for one, some you might get 0, some you might get 1, some you might get 0. But suppose if you're this university, if this university is not accepting multi-gender, it is having only unique, for example, only male boys college or only females or girls college, then it should have only 0. It should become, entire thing will become 0. This is one of the disadvantage of using Gower's general dissimilarity coefficient. So because of this, don't go for this. Go for your previous this thing. Go for this simple one. Go for the simple one, because this is a simple, easier way. If you're having male and female, just replace with 1 and 0. Calculate for entire thing. You got it as minus 5 square is 25, plus minus 3 square is 9, plus 0 minus 1 whole square is minus 1 square. So this also will become 1. So square root of 35, you are getting somewhere around 5.88 or something, right? Getting my point?
Yes.
Yes. So this is one of the easiest way to do your distance calculation. Apart from this, we have some concept. So did we discuss about this yesterday? Yes or no? No. So now these are some of the concepts of your clustering. Distance between clusters, that is called as your single linkage. Single linkage. The single linkage is called as nearest neighbor. So consider that you're having two clusters. This is one cluster, this is another cluster. So distance between two clusters is nothing but your this part. See, minimum distance between members of the two clusters is called as your nearest neighbor, or you can call it as single linkage. So if somebody asks you, what do you mean by single linkage? It is nothing but the minimum distance between the members of the two clusters is called as your single linkage. Single linkage. And distance between clusters is, with respect to complete linkage, it is called as farthest neighbor. Farthest means greatest distance between the members of the two clusters is being considered as your complete linkage or farthest distance. Farthest distance. See, these two clusters, you are calculating the largest distance between the members of the two clusters. So that is called as your farthest neighbor. Farthest neighbor. farthest neighbor. This is called as your average linkage. This is called as your average linkage. Average linkage is nothing but if you're having two clusters, it will calculate the distance between each and every members of the clusters, and it will take average of all the distances between the members of the two clusters. That is called as your average linkage. That is called as your average linkage. Next concept is called as your centroid linkage, distance between the two clusters with respect to centers. So this is one, this is one. So each and every cluster will have one center point, and that center point, the distance between those center points are called as your centroid linkage. And this concept we are going to discuss in non-hierarchical clustering. Non-hierarchical clustering. And this non-hierarchical clustering name is called as k-means cluster. K-means cluster. And when it comes to hierarchical clustering, we are going to use complete linkage in real time. Complete linkage in real time. Either you can use single linkage or average linkage also, but your clusters will not be having feasible way. I'll show you the difference when we start implementing. I'll show you the difference. How does your single linkage cluster looks? How does your complete linkage cluster looks? And also how does your average linkage cluster looks? But in real time, with respect to hierarchical clustering, we go with complete linkage. Non-hierarchical clustering, we go with k-means clustering. K-means clustering. See, pairwise distance between clusters, whatever we have discussed, just note down this sentence. Rakesh, are you there? Same, it is whatever we have discussed, the same thing has been repeated here. So this is your hierarchical cluster dendrogram. Dendrogram is nothing but your tree-like structure. This diagram is called as your dendrogram. Tree-like structure that represents clustering is called as dendrogram. So now this is the question for you all. So why we should do cluster universities? So how can clustering help a prospective applicant? Think that you are applying, you are an applicant to apply for that particular university, how does it help you? How does it help you?
So based on the clustering, we can understand what are the top universities where we should apply. And that can also help yes. us to prepare.
Yes, consider that you got 95% in your exam. Will you apply for tier 1 college or tier 5 college?
Tier 1.
Tier 1. So if you get 35%, you are going to apply for this or this?
Tier 5.
Tier 5. Why not tier 1? You know that you are not going to get
eligibility.
Yes, you won't get the eligibility. So that is the reason, being a applicant, you can identify based on your requirement, whether sometimes it is not only with respect to marks, you can also check with respect to the graduation rate. Also, you can decide which college you want to join, or based on your expenses or your fees, right? Based on the fees also, we decide which college to join, which university to join. That is how it helps your applicant. How about this one? Business school dean, consider that you are running. Okay, consider that your business school dean is the chairman of your business school. Chairman, how does it help him to do business? How does clustering helps him?
For categorizing on something.
Yes, on something. What something? That is my question, right?
On the different strategy or something.
Maybe Yogesh, the amount of fees that they are going to collect.
Probably you can consider that, or else also you can think, for example, Stanford University is there and Harvard University, both comes under top universities. Both comes under top universities. Harvard is offering data science course, for example, data science in MS, but Stanford is not offering this. Stanford will check that we are also number one. Why don't we start a data science with MS course? Because Harvard is giving the same and they are having approximately 100 students one academic year. So why don't we also start with same course with a different name so that we also get into this business? So they can identify their competitors and they can fix up there, or they can compete with others. They can compete with others. Got it? Now, let me go and ask you the next questions. Evaluating usefulness of clustering. So now, first thing is you should characterize each cluster based on what you are characterizing your cluster, based on fees or based on SAT score or based on expense or based on graduation rate or based on placements or based on some other feature. Are you going to characterize each cluster, or how is it? That one you should do. And what about this? Can you give a name to each cluster?
Yeah.
Yes, you should give, because if you don't give the name to each cluster, if I tell cluster A, cluster B, cluster C, which cluster is top one cluster?
Cluster A.
How? Did I tell you that cluster A is top? Bharat, you cannot tell, right? If I just link cluster one, cluster B, cluster C. If somebody asks you, where do you work, Bharat? You are telling that company. Debanshu will tell this company. Lari will tell that and this company. Somebody will tell this company. Which company? Your company should have name, right?
Correct.
So I cannot tell A company, B company, C company, D company, right? What about this last one? does this gives us any insight? For example, you name a cluster as private university, government university, deemed university, autonomous university. Does this gives us any insight?
Yes.
Yes. So yes, this will give you an insight saying that, okay, this particular university belongs to, all the clusters belongs to private universities. All the university in this cluster belongs to government universities. All the college or university belongs to deemed university. Like this, you will come to know the university classifications, and it should give you some insights. It should give you some insights. Now, see, if you use single linkage, your cluster looks like this. Is that visible? Visible, but I'll show you the complete linkage. Tell me which one is better. Single linkage, see the graph once again. This is your dendrogram. See. And now I'm going to move to complete linkage. Which one is better? Complete is better or single is better?
Complete is better.
Complete.
Complete linkage is better because that is the reason I told you, because it will be calculated, the distance between the clusters will be calculated based on the maximum distance. As it is, complete linkage is called as the distance between members of the two clusters will be calculated based on the maximum distance. So this is the importance of your complete linkage or single linkage. And single linkage, it will not be having distance between the clusters very, very far. So it will be very, very close to each other. So this is your, see, distance between clusters are very close to each other. See, this is one cluster, this is another cluster, this is another cluster, this is another cluster, this is another cluster, 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 like this. Or else if you see here also, it is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, like this. So until and unless you cut at this point also, there are clusters are very close to each other. So that is the reason in your real time, when you are implementing your hierarchical clustering, go for complete linkage, not complete distance. Here it is single linkage. Go for complete linkage. Once you get your dendrogram, you should cut down your dendrogram to form the number of clusters. See, from dendrograms you should obtain two clusters. So after dendrogram is obtained, cut it to create clusters. So if I cut down at this point, this red line, how many clusters can I form?
Two clusters.
Yes, I can form two clusters, one and two. So examine distance levels. So this is your distance. This y-axis is nothing but your distance. Cut point determines the number of clusters. If you cut down at this particular point, you can form two clusters. Suppose if you cut down at this line,
three or four.
Correctly tell me. See correctly and tell me.
Three.
Yes, it is exactly three, because you can see here, it is here. And here you can see, if you hold this, you're going to get one cluster. So if you cut down at this point, you're going to get three clusters. If I cut down at this last line,
four clusters.
So four clusters will be obtained if I cut down at the distance of 3.8 or 3.9. So once your cut point determines the number of clusters, you can obtain the statistics on resulting clusters. Obtain statistics on resulting cluster means, so each and every cluster, you can see what is the average SAT score, what is the average top 10 ratio, or what is the average graduation rate of this cluster separately, this cluster separately, this cluster and this cluster separately. For example, this is your computer science, information science, electronics and mechanical, for example. So you can see how many students have scored first class. What is the average top 10 in computer science? And what is the average placement ratio of computer science? Like this, for each and every department, you can come up with average scores. Or it can be average or it can be median. It depends on your requirement. Depends on your requirement. So next is your non-hierarchical clustering. Before going to non-hierarchical clustering, let me show you how to implement hierarchical clustering using R. Using R Studio. Let me delete everything. Control L. Let me delete all these things. So this function, I'm going to use a function called as read underscore Excel. So read underscore Excel is not working in my system because I've not installed Java in my system. So instead of using this, I'm going to use this import data set from Excel to import a data set from my local system. From my local system, I'm going to use this university underscore clustering data set from my local system, and I'm clicking on this. See, this is your data set. This is your data set: university, state, SAT score, top 10 acceptance, student, faculty, expenses, and graduation rate. So coming to this point, oh shit. I'm going to put this into a variable called as input. This university underscore clustering into a variable called as So I'm going to create a new variable called as input, which is having same number of records, which is imported from your local system. Local system. I want to remove this university underscore clustering. What is the function to remove that? What is the function to remove that?
Remove.
RM.
Remove. It is RM. It is RM. So I will be writing a function called as RM. RM of university underscore clustering. See, this has been removed. This has been removed. So what about this line of code does?
Mm-hmm.
Anything written within square parentheses is rows, comma, columns. Try to read this now. Input is your data set name.
So it's going to take 1 to 25th row. And then as per the columns are concerned.
Yes, as per the
first
columns.
Column and 3 to 8.
Yes, first column you're taking, second column you're dropping, 3 to 8, yeah. All the columns you are taking. 1, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. I'm dropping my second column and creating one variable called as my data. My data. So now you can see here my data set is having 25 observations as it is, but out of 8 variables, only 7 variables have been selected. I've dropped a column called as
university class.
Not university, it is state. Second column okay. Was yes. Now, I want to do scaling. As I told you that your data is having different units and also different what we should do if you're having different units and scaling issue?
Normalization,
or you can go for
standardization
in order to solve your scaling issue and your units issue. Yes. So here you can see that I'm going to use a function called as scale. Scale, my data is nothing but my data set name, and anything written here in square parentheses, rows, comma, columns, I'm including all the rows. And why I'm including from second column to seventh column?
Need to check the data set.
You okay, have written excluding university name.
Yes, excluding university name. You are standardizing all the, because based on this university names only you should categorize, right? You should cluster it. That's the reason I'm just not including my university name, and I'm just including my second column to my seventh column by using a function called as scale. I'm going to do standardization or normalization. So once you do standardization and normalization, this will not be 22,000, 13, 22, 99, and 1310. Everything will be in your standardized numbers. So let me try to implement scaling or standardization and store it in a variable called as normalize underscore data. See, now I'm going to open this normalized underscore data. See, earlier expenses was 65,000, 35,000, 25,000. That's the reason. So this is your standardized data. This is your standardized data. By using a function called as scale, we have standardized your original data to normalized data. So after calculating or after doing your standardization, you should calculate the distance. You should calculate the distance between 1 to 2, 1 to 3, 1 to 4 until 1 to 25. Again, 2, 3, 2, 4, 2, 5 until 2 to 25. Again, 3 till 25, 4 till 25. Until 24 to 25, you need to calculate the distance. You need to calculate the distance. For that calculation of distance, we are having a function called as dist. Dist is a function to calculate your distance and normalized method. So what is this normalized underscore data?
The data after normalized, that is a variable.
It is your scaled data or your standardized data that is stored in a variable called as normalized data. This becomes your data set now. This becomes your data set.
Sir.
Now I'm going to implement distance formula called as Euclidean distance. Euclidean distance. So I'm going to store this distance in a variable called as D. So let me run this line of code and see what is there in your D. See, I'm going to run D now. So if you run D, you're going to get the distance like this. See, from 1 till 7, next it will be 8 to like that, until 25 rows it will be there, and starting from 2, because the distance between 1 to 1 will be 1, 1 to 1 will be 0, 2 to 2 will be 0. See, 2 to 2 is not displayed. 2 to 2 is 0, it is not displayed. 3 to 3 will be 0, it is not displayed. 4 to 4 will not be displayed. So it starts from 1 on your row wise and 2 from your, because 1 to 1 it will be 0. So these are the distance which are being calculated between 1 to 2, 2 to 3, 2 to 4, 3 to 4, 3 to 2, 3 to 1, like this. 3 to 4, 3 to 5, 3 to 6. So this is the distance that has been calculated before implementing your hierarchical clustering. Hierarchical clustering. Is it clear for everyone?
Yeah.
Now, after calculating your distance, you are going to implement an algorithm called as hierarchical clustering. Hierarchical clustering by using a function called as hclust. By using a function called as hclust. One sec, I don't have power. So by using a function called as hclust, you can apply hierarchical clustering. And D, what is D?
D is an after distance for all the distance.
The Euclidean distance.
Yes. The whatever the distance we calculated between all the universities that is stored in a variable called as D. So for a hierarchical clustering, you should pass your parameter called as distance D, and method is equal to complete linkage. Method is equal to, either you can pass it as single or whether you can pass it as average linkage also. So let me just choose one. So let me just choose copy, and I'm going to create all the three, single, average, and also I'll show you how to do this. So I'm going to put as fit one. I'm going to change it as single linkage. Single linkage. Here I'm going to write it as average linkage. Here one more, let me try to do with respect to centroid linkage as well. Centroid linkage as well. I'm going to change the variable names into fit1, fit, fit2, fit3. Fit2. Here I'm going to change it to fit3. So I'm going to build clustering algorithm on all four methods, on all four methods by using a function called as hclust. Hclust. Hclust, complete, single, average, centroid. So what does this line of code gives you? Question mark hclust.
Help of yes. That function.
Yes, help of this particular function. If you want to use, you can type it as hclust question mark hclust, or you can directly go to help section, or you can directly go to help section. So I'm going to run this. See, I'm going to, let me just go for some other function, and then later I'll go into execute. See, I'm going to dist function as of now, but I'm going to execute this question mark hclust. It will automatically change this help section to hclust function. So it is just a help section. So now I have built four models. One is fit, fit one, fit two, fit three. One is complete, single, average, and centroid. So I want to plot. I want to plot my dendrogram. So if I pass this fit variable, that is nothing but your output of your hierarchical clustering model, you're going to get your dendrogram. So here I'm going to use dendrogram as plot of fit. plot of it. So what is the function to plot your scatter plot?
PLT dot plot.
That is you are telling about your Python, Lahari. Plot, right? Plot is a function. Plot of x comma y, right? Yes, Bharat. Yes, it is plot of x comma y. But here, if you use plot, and if you pass output of your hierarchical clustering algorithm, you will not get your hierarchical clusterings like similar like your scatter plot. You will get dendrogram like this. You will get a dendrogram like this. So let me try to run this line of code and show you how does it look. Windows. I'm going to write it as Windows function, and I'm going to open an external window. Then I'm going to write plot of it. See, this is your cluster dendrogram. So this cluster dendrogram is nothing but your cluster dendrogram is nothing but your tree like structure. So it is not organized. One is starting here, one is ending here, one is starting here, one is ending here. So it is not organized. So I'm going to use one more keyword called as ang is equal to minus one. So if I use this ang is equal to minus one along with your plot of fit, everything will be organized in a single style, single horizontal way. Everything will be organized. That's it, nothing else. So now coming to this cluster dendrogram, if I cut down at this point, I'll be able to form two clusters. This is your four clusters. This is your single linkage or complete linkage?
It is complete.
Complete,
it is complete linkage, because you can see here fit is complete linkage. I plotted fit. I plotted fit. Now I'm going to plot fit one. So if I plot fit one, you should see similar graph, but it will be in your single linkage. I'm going to use plot of fit one. So you got the difference? Got the difference? Yeah. Even though if I cut down at this point, it is not feasible. Even if I cut down at this point, you'll be able to form multiple clusters. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. For 25 students or for 25 universities, having 10 clusters is not feasible. It's not feasible. It is not only with respect to universities. If you're having 25 class students, how many classroom you need? Worst case, maximum of 2 to 3 classrooms is enough. I'm telling you, if you are putting 8 students in one class, Bharat, or 2 class or anything. So, but here for 8 students, you are having, if you cut down at this point, you are having 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So for each and every classroom, you should have 2 students. This is not a phase. So now let me try to plot your fit 2. Let me try to plot your fit 2. Fit 2 is nothing but your average linkage. Fit 2 is nothing but your average linkage. So I'm going to see your average link. See, average linkage is also okay, but you can see that again, it is slightly not that much feasible. Slightly not that much feasible, but it is comparatively better than your single linkage. Better than single linkage. Now I'm going to plot with respect to fit 3, your centroid linkage. Let us see, will it work or not? So this is your centroid linkage. See, this is like this, 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 and this is coming like this, this is coming like this. So this is your hierarchical clustering. If you go with centroid linkage, it is not feasible. So in non-hierarchical clustering, it works on centroid linkage. So that is the reason you should go with your complete linkage for your hierarchical clustering. Hierarchical clustering. Clear for everyone?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes.
Now coming to this. Now once your dendrogram is obtained, I'm cutting down my dendrogram by using a function called as cut tree. What is this fit? What is this fit?
It is hierarchical
clustering model name. Hierarchical clustering model name. And what is this k is equal to 5? Number of clusters. You want 5 clusters. You are specifying k is equal to 5. Okay. K is equal to 5. And storing it in a variable called as groups. So if I run this line of code, and if you see what is there in your groups, it will display the number of clusters, which university belongs to which cluster. So totally you're having 25 universities, and here also you're having 25 records. So this will display which university, first university belongs to first cluster, second belongs to second cluster, third belongs to third cluster, 25th belongs to second cluster, 24th belongs to fourth cluster. Like this, it is going to display the number, which cluster or which university belongs to which cluster, which university belongs to which cluster. Now I want to see my plot of fit I've run, right? So I want to cut down my plot. See, I plotted my cluster dendrogram here. So I want to see how my cluster dendrogram will be cutted into 5 clusters based on the algorithm. So for that there is a function called as rect.hclust. rect.hclust fit is your algorithm name. I'm specifying 5 clusters and your borders, means if you're having clusters like this, how this has been cut down into one cluster. It will show in a red color border. Red color border. Let me try to run this line of code and see your plot. Getting the difference? So this is your one cluster. See the border. One cluster, two cluster, three cluster, four cluster, five cluster. See, this three university belongs to only one single cluster. This cluster is having only one university. Getting my point?
Hey Yogesh, can you repeat that line?
This line. See, you have figured out 5 clusters. So you want to see how your dendrogram has been cutting down into clusters to form groups. Okay. So for that, there is a function called as rect.hclust. You're passing your algorithm name called as fit, and k is equal to 5, number of clusters, and your giving border is equal to red, means this is your dendrogram, for example. So you are forming this as one cluster, this as another cluster, this as another cluster, this as another cluster. You are just visualizing it. How does your cluster has been formed?
Yogesh, can we change the value of k, or is it we need to take it based on?
No, you can change it. See, I'm going to change it to 3 now, for example. Okay, because I've run it. Okay, what I'll do is I'll close this and I'll run once again. Windows. Plot of fit. K is equal to 3. See, now only
it creates 3 clusters.
This is okay, the big cluster.
3 cluster. Okay.
Yes. Got the difference, Larry, now? What it has been displayed?
So Yogesh, yesterday you mentioned about the clustering formula, which is square root n by 2. Is that a standard that you have to follow?
It is just a thumb rule standard. What we follow, okay, in real time, I follow square root of n by 2. So that just I'm putting randomly as 5 and 3. So if you are having 10,000 records, you can take square root of n by 2. Square root of 10,000 by 2. Based on that, you can decide how many clusters you want.
Right. Sometimes business may come up with their own requirement, like how many clusters.
If the business tells how many clusters they want, it is up to them.
Yeah,
but absolutely. If they don't tell,
that's the thumb rule that we have to follow.
Yes, that's the thumb rule we need to follow.
Sure, thanks.
Okay, now what is this line of code does is not like this. I'm going to create it into tabular format as dot data dot frame. So this groups, right? Just now we created groups. This displayed 1, 2, 3, 1, 1, 2, 2 like this, right? So I'm just creating this in a tabular format and creating it into a variable called as membership. Storing it in a variable called as membership. See, your membership is having like this. 1, 2, 3, 1, 1, 2, 2 like this it is displayed. Earlier it was in your list format. So now it has been into tabular format as your data dot frame. Data dot frame. Now, what does this line of code does? I'll be slightly faster now because I don't have charge in my laptop. That's the reason.
Creating the data frame.
Yes, you are creating a data frame. What about these two, membership and my data? That is my question.
My data is.
Yeah, tell me. Go ahead.
My data is the one which you remove university name.
Yes, you mean to say original data set.
Yeah,
I think we are merging two data sets.
Yes, you are merging two data sets. See, my data is my original data set. And what is this membership?
Membership is after
converted data frame package.
Creating the clusters.
Yeah, we created a cluster, right? Which university belongs to which cluster? That number, cluster number. And I'm going to combine these two data sets into one variable called as final by using data dot frame. Data dot frame. See, now I'm going to run this line of code final and display you what is there in your final data set. See, universities at top 10 is your original variables. And I'm adding a group called as membership cluster number. Brown University belongs to first cluster. Caltech belongs to second cluster. CMU belongs to third cluster. Columbia belongs to first cluster. Cornell belongs to like this. So this is nothing but your cluster number. Cluster number. Clear? And this is for no use. Return it for something else. So now this is final one is not there. So now once you are everything is done. If you want to write down your output into a local system, you can use a function called as library.xls, library xlsx. I think in my system, it will not work because I'm not installed Java. So that's the reason I'm getting this error. R Java is not there. So let me give it a try. So whatever the final output is there, right? Along with your output cluster number, I'm going to store it in a variable called as final. One, sorry, it is not final one, it is final, right? It is final. So here I'm going to remove this final and I'm going to use a function called as write.xlsx. Save it as in your local system, save it as final1.xlsx. Whatever name you want, you can give. For example, I'm going to give today's date, September 21st. So I'm going to run this. See, if I run this, I'm going to get this error because I've not installed R Java. So instead of using XLSX, I'm going to save it as CSV. Write.csv. And where it will be saved? Where it will be saved?
In the same directory where our script is running.
Same directory. It is nothing but your present working directory. It will be saved. If you want to know your present working directory, there is a function called as getwd. So this is my current working directory. Current working directory. So I'm going to run this line of code write.csv and I'll go to this path called as documents. You're able to see September 21st, which is created just now, which is created just now. So let me open this file. It is nothing but it will have your final results in your local system. That's it, nothing else. There's no rocket science behind that. It is still opening. See, this is your serial number, forget it, and this is your cluster group or membership or number, and this is your data set. Brown University belongs to first, like this. So this is how you can save into your local system by using a function called as write.csv. write.csv. This is all about your hierarchical clustering. This is all about your hierarchical clustering. So any questions? Any questions?
So, Yogesh, is there a possibility for you, possibly in upcoming sessions, to publish one of these algorithms so that we can consume it and use it in the real world applications? I don't know whether that is part of the scope.
Which application?
So, we have built a couple of models, right?
Yes.
For example, over here, we just have developed a hierarchical model. Now, if
yes.
I have to use it to predict something for an application, let's say I have a web page, from there I want to use this model to predict some values. Would you be able to showcase us, you know, how we can publish it as a web service or how we can deploy it?
No, no, that is not a part. See, deployment is you should have your published servers. You should have AWS or some other servers, right?
Right. Yeah. So, yeah.
But see,
that's what I wanted to
confirm. Yeah. Ultimately, your work will be to build your algorithm and give it to your client or to your UI team.
Yep.
In our team, we have reporting team separately, data science team separately, and deployment team separately. Deployment team separately. And each and every company will have same. So, data science team will be having comprising of 3 to 5 categories: DB team, UI team, data science analytics model building team, that is our team, and reporting team, and then deployment team. All these teams will be there. So our job is to implement machine learning algorithms and explain about this code, how does it works, and what is the impact on the business.
So do you need to provide that model to the UI team so that they can publish it?
Yes.
Is there any kind
yes.
of output
yes.
package that we have to export? Okay.
No, nothing package. You should give this code. They will use this code and they will try to deploy it, or they will try to build a web app or a mobile app. It is up to them.
Okay.
And
okay.
it depends on your client, not depends on your UI team. It depends on your client. If your client has paid for that, then your business will do that. If they are not, only they'll give this algorithm to your client. That's it.
All right. Thanks, Yogesh.
Okay. Okay, thank you all. I don't have my system power, sorry for that. So I thought of continuing with non-hierarchical clustering theory part. So theory part is not much, only one slide it is. There is no much difference between your non-hierarchical clustering. So I'm going to take that one slide in the next session along with your implementation of your non-hierarchical clustering. This non-hierarchical clustering is called as your K-means cluster. K-means cluster. This K stands for 5, 4, anything. This K stands for number of clusters. Okay.
So is it same like KNN clustering, Yogesh?
No, KNN is not a cluster. KNN is your classification algorithm. Who is this?
Okay. So this is Sanjay.
Sanjay, the KNN is not your clustering. This is your classification algorithm. K means is different. KNN is different. Yeah. Most of them will get confused with respect to this name because KNN, K means. Yeah. K means is for clustering and this is for classification.
Right. Thanks, Yogesh. Appreciate it.
Thank you. Thank you all. Happy weekend.
Thanks. Happy weekend, everyone.
Yeah, fine. See, my laptop battery also gone. Sorry. Thank you. Good night.
Thanks. Bye.